the response, well, why should I have you tell me how to use interpreters? I'm not in the least bit interested. And so that made me pause and start to think about what my role is and how it is that I work with teaching interpreters and working with interpreters. And of course, as a consumer, I use interpreter services quite frequently. But it made me stop and think that I had never considered the fact that deaf people have issues related to the use of interpreters. It made me realize that we never really had stopped to think, what happens inside? It isn't just a how-to process. And as I began to investigate this, I began to realize that there's almost two camps that have been set up, and that there has become a struggle between those two camps. When I discuss this and ask questions of people in both groups, I've begun to analyze and recognize the dynamics that exist. For this presentation, I'm going to take a look at the views that exist between the two groups. Let me start off with a story, and I'll present that story through a cartoon. Take a look at the cartoon. All right, here in the cartoon, I think this is a really good example, because here we have a deaf man who has gone into a bank and he's ready to hold it up. And he has that goal, and he intends to achieve his goal, and he has made arrangements even for communication. He's brought an interpreter with him, and he expects that the interpreter will do her job, and the interpreter has her goal, and she will give me the right for direct communication. Now the bank teller, he says, look at me, don't look at the interpreter, I'm here to rob your bank. Now the interpreter has abilities to address language and culture. She's certified and she is capable of giving the deaf person the opportunity to achieve his goals. And her goal is to make sure that they have rightful communication and that that communication takes place. Once the robbery takes place, the deaf person says thanks and takes off. And so the interpreter then starts running after the deaf person and is apprehended. When she's brought to the station, they begin interrogating her. Who are you? Oh, well, I'm just the interpreter. And so they go, well, what does that entail? And so she begins explaining her role of the interpreter. And they said, all right, now then tell me, who is the deaf man? And of course, the interpreter immediately says, well, you can't ask me. I must abide by the code of ethics. It's confidential. Now, remember my use of this sign of confidential. We'll discuss that a little bit later. But anyway, she says, it's confidential. I can't tell you. You won't tell me? All right, fine. Then we'll put you in jail. And therein lies the dilemma. Now, another story that I'd like to tell. Really comes from a mafia story, and this story has changed throughout time. There have been many, many versions of this story, but the basic concepts of this story remain the same, regardless of its version. We have a dark evening, and there is a moon in the sky, a full moon with clouds, and it's out in the countryside, and there are trees and one lone house. And near the trees, there are three men, and they are stealthily digging and digging a hole, and their intent is to bury something. Over in the house, in the window, shining through the window is a light reflecting the shadow of a man. And all of a sudden, the three men say, look, look, we're being watched. Hurry up. Let's cover up our hole and take off. And they do so. Now, these three men, they go back to their mafia don, who is responsible for this whole part of the area. And they said, well, we went and did what you told us to do. We went to try and get the $10 million owed you. And when we got there, we did everything we could, but they didn't have the money and they weren't able to give us the money. And so we struggled and tried our best. So now, since we failed, what would you like us to do? And the Don listened to what they had to say and felt that they were lying, and so he called in his three thugs, and he said, all right, one at a time. And the thugs beat them and beat the person trying to get information, and the individual denied it, and even though he was beaten, he never was able to reveal anything, and he died. So they brought in the second man. He said, and the thugs beat him and said, tell us what you know. And he wouldn't, and he denied any information, and he died as well, which left one last man. And he said, now you see your friends have died. He says, tell me. And he says, no, no, I have nothing to say. I don't. And so he was beaten and beaten and beaten to get information from him. And finally, he says, I'll tell you, I'll tell you, I'll confess. He says, out in the country, and he gave the name of the street. He says, there's the edge of the forest, and there's one lone house there. And there was a man who was watching us, and at that point in the story, he died. So the Mafia Don thought, fine, I think we can find that location. So he took his three thugs with him, and they went to the location that had been described, and they were on the right street, and they saw the forest, and even the house that appeared to be the one described. So he knocked on the door and rang the doorbell, and the lights flashed, which he thought was rather odd. And when the man opened the door, he indicated that he couldn't hear. And the Don said, you can't hear? Oh, drat. Well, okay, okay, I've got a plan. So they all left. And time later, he came back with an interpreter. Now, here was Miss Interpreter, and she was all ready and eager to work. And when they arrived, he rang the doorbell, and the door opened. And the deaf man again answered. And he says, oh, it's the same people. He goes, well, I'm the interpreter, and I'm here to communicate for you. And he goes, well, what do you want? And the Don said, you remember last night? You remember you saw there were three men out near the trees digging a hole or something? And the deaf man kind of thought about it, and he said, well, I'm not really sure what you're talking about. What are you referring to? And he goes, I know that you saw what they were doing. You tell me where they were digging that hole. And he's like, what do you mean? And the interpreter is doing her job, and she's interpreting everything that's being said. And he goes, no, wait a minute. He became a little bit frightened, and so he couldn't really think quickly enough. He says, no, wait a minute. And the Don said, if you don't tell me where that money is, I'll blow you away. And of course, the deaf man immediately thought, money? Oh, you're going to kill me? No, okay, I'll tell you where I saw him. There, you see those trees right over there? And that's where they dug the hole, and he described what he had seen. And the Don is quietly waiting while the interpreter listens to everything that she sees him say. And then the interpreter turns to the Don and said, I won't tell you. Never, never, never will I tell you. You'll have to kill me first. And the Don said, fine. And he blew him away, and the deaf man was killed. And I thought, well, we're not going to know where this money is, but we'll find it later. So he took off. Now a month passes, and the interpreter has disappeared from sight, to be found living later on an island. This story, it has become a part of deaf culture folklore and has been passed down throughout the years. And it doesn't matter what changes to its form have taken. The point is that it has very significant issues reflected within this story. Is the interpreter trusted? Is there a doubt to what interpreters will do, a withholding of information? Oppression issues are addressed. This story is really a cultural story that helps deaf people share their experiences and share the fact that they have common experiences, and they incorporate humor in a way that they can help them to take care of their feelings and make them feel better. But this story, I think, reflects a great deal, and I think tells us all a lot. You know, when I ask deaf people throughout the country how they feel about interpreting services, I've heard a number of stories, and these are the kinds of things that they will tell me. Well, with interpreters, I feel like I don't have any control, and an interpreter immediately takes control, and there's nothing that I can do. I'm powerless in the situation. Or maybe they'll say, the interpreter gives me such total control that I don't even know what to do. Nobody's ever told me how I could handle the particular situation, and I feel awkward, and I feel like I'm going to look like an idiot or a fool. And sometimes interpreters don't even pass on all of the information, and they retain information for their own benefit and don't even pass it on to the deaf person. Also, deaf people will say they feel a lack of privacy because the interpreter might go and interpret at the doctor's office, and then later when I go to borrow money at a bank, and then they find out information about how much I earn, and then the same interpreter is there, and later with my employer, I might have difficulties on the job, and I have the same interpreter, and perhaps I'm meeting with my son or daughter's instructor, and it's the same interpreter once again, and they know all of these different things about my personal life, and that is such a violation of privacy. Or sometimes deaf people say, well, I took a test and I flunked the test and I know it's the interpreter's fault. I know it's the interpreter's fault. Or they'll say, I went to a job interview and I was fully prepared and felt really good about it, but then I wasn't offered the job. And I feel that the reason why I didn't get that job is because of the interpreter. Or they may say they went to the job interview and when they got there, there was more interaction between the employer and the interpreter, that the person interviewing seemed to direct questions more to the interpreter, and I had to say, wait a minute, I'm the one here for the interview. And later to find out that the interpreter was the one offered the job. Why isn't it that if I went for the interview that I'm not offered the job? So I might say, well, you know, and a deaf person might tell an interpreter, you know, your earrings are a little bit distracting, or could you, you know, deal with your hair a little bit because it's in your face. Maybe could you trim your nails, or the fingernail polish is too bright. Maybe no fingernail polish would be better. Or even if I make suggestions about their signs, you know, but I'm afraid to do so because I fear that the interpreter never will come back and that I will not get interpreter services, or that they will get back at me by retaining information and not interpreting faithfully. And in that way, there will be retribution. So I feel a loss of control. Or they'll say, well, you know why interpreters interpret anyway, because they're out for the money, and they just like all the money that they can make for it. They have absolutely no interest in worrying about deaf people's interests or their feelings or concerns. And other times, deaf people will share with me that they've taught ASL classes, and they share their experiences in parts of deaf culture and teach, and the school or the college pays me $10 or $20, even $25 an hour. But then the interpreter earns $20 to $50 an hour, and there's a real inequity there. I mean, deaf people will complain that interpreters find employment easily, and yet there are limited employment opportunities for deaf people, and it's very difficult for deaf people to find good sites for employment. Or sometimes I'll even share with deaf people that interpreting is a great deal of responsibility, and there's so much going on with having to take in the message and process that information in order to interpret accurately. They have to have so much background knowledge about the topic and the situation. And it's physically demanding, standing, and they become physically exhausted and mentally exhausted. And the deaf person says, well, I become exhausted too, having to keep my eyes peeled on an interpreter constantly until my eyes are just ready to fall out. And I've spent all my time trying to teach them and everything, and that's exhausting as well. I mean, I don't see any difference. Or a deaf person will say, you know, I may need an interpreter immediately, and then I'll be told, well, we'll have to schedule that appointment for 2 weeks down the road. And it's like my life goes completely on hold, and I have to wait for 2 weeks before we can proceed with the meeting or whatever, simply because of interpreter services. So does that mean I have to put my life on hold? If you think about it, people have access to water, and they turn on the faucet and the water comes immediately. And with electrical services, you turn on a light and the lights come on immediately. Even with accessibility issues, ramping is provided, and they're there at any time that a handicapped person would need that ramp. I mean, it's simply a view of having utility services. Utilities are available at all times, and shouldn't interpreter services be viewed just as a utility is viewed? You get direct services. If I pick up the phone and I dial 1-800-ASL-TERP, ASL-TERP, I should be able to say, hello, I need an interpreter, and I get one immediately. That it's difficult when I have to wait until I can get the interpreter. Perhaps even on the job. You know, maybe we dress rather casually, and here comes Miss Interpreter in with her suit and her little briefcase, and she's all Miss Professional, and I'm like, hey, this is a pretty low-key place. And this isn't a situation where the interpreter needs to be so overdressed. Or it may be the opposite situation, where it's a very professional situation and the interpreter comes walking in with just blue jeans and a top, that's very embarrassing because the interpreter reflects me ultimately. And so please dress appropriately for the situation, I'll be told. Also, the issue of control. Who controls the communication? Oftentimes the interpreter will say, well, wait a minute, the hearing person's not finished talking. Wait, 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 they're not done. And they continue to sign and continue to interpret. And sometimes the deaf person wants to interrupt, but they have to wait until they're given the opportunity to take their turn. And they'll say, but wait a minute, I want to make my comment at this point. And they go, no, wait, 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 the hearing person's still talking. And that is something that we really detest. Maybe I'll go to a meeting and there's a hearing presenter. Now, the hearing person begins talking, but the interpreter stands there, and deaf people say, come on, start signing, because they're speaking. And the interpreter's like, wait a minute, just wait, wait, wait. And then they nod, and like they get ready to start, and they start interpreting. And that's so uncomfortable, because why is it that the interpreter's having to listen and hold on to that information? Get started. Come on, I want to know what's being said. And so maybe it's a deaf speaker. And so they start signing, and the interpreter watches for a while, and they'll say, well, come on, go ahead and start voicing. And they'll say, no, come on, keep talking, keep signing your message. And it's confusing. It's very uncomfortable when the interpreter just stands there waiting. I don't even understand what the reason is for that. Why is that that's part of their job, so to speak? They don't understand process time. People within the deaf community just simply don't understand that. Oftentimes they feel that there is an inequity in power between deaf people and interpreters. If I go back to my mafia story that I told you a moment ago, the feelings that are reflected in that story of ambivalence and lack of trust really are very real feelings that deaf people have. So I am going to use the term as it's shown on the screen. All right. This term, hostile dependency, I'm going to use hostile dependency as a way to address these feelings. Hostile dependency really reflects how deaf people feel about interpreters. Oftentimes they feel vulnerable. Oftentimes they feel a sense of fear and weakness, and they feel that interpreters will take advantage of them, and that they will lose a sense of control and a sense of their own rights to keep use of my own senses and how I want the communication to take place. And when one has to depend on an interpreter, just because there is a dependence on the interpreter doesn't mean that one necessarily trusts the interpreter. Because deaf people recognize that they need interpreter services, but they don't necessarily want to use interpreter services. Oftentimes they want total independence. They want to be able to do what they want to be able to do. But there's that recognition that first I need to make arrangements for interpreter services. And they resent that need for an interpreter. And so, okay, fine, there's an interpreter provided, but that's part of hostile dependency. So deaf people often feel a great deal of anger. And the reason is because there's a loss of privacy, a loss of control, and a feeling of vulnerability. And the fact that they feel that interpreters know too much about me and that they will judge me, ultimately. Also, deaf people feel that there is really a feeling of indirect communication rather than direct communication. They're always having to go through a third party. And that they're really communicating more directly with the interpreter rather than the hearing person. And that's not a real sense of reality. I mean, I feel like I've left the situation talking to an interpreter, not the hearing person that I intended to be communicating to. And there's a sense of unrealness to that experience. Deaf people would like to have direct communication with the hearing people they're interacting with. And also there's a lack of trust in whether or not the interpreters are truly proficient. Are they truly capable of doing both expressive and receptive interpreting? Are they going to always interpret accurately what the hearing person says? How is the deaf person going to have control over that, or even knowledge of whether it's accurate or not? I mean, are they going to be able to really accurately interpret what I say? Hostile dependency really varies throughout the deaf community. And it depends on a number of factors. The first one is the education. how many deaf people have the full educational opportunities, and what was their educational experience, their life experiences? Did they use interpreter services frequently or just on occasion? Rarely, perhaps. The age of the individual. If we take a look at age, if the person is in their 20s and attended mainstream programs where there was an educational interpreter who often had control over the students versus perhaps a deaf person who's 30 or 40 and their primary education was through residential school or perhaps even a day school where they attended classes with all deaf students. Or even if they're older, in 40s or 50s, and it's their total experience was at the residential school using ASL. And the older person who really experienced interpreters, but those interpreters were hearing children of deaf parents, or perhaps even the pastor who worked with the deaf people in that community and can sign, or a teacher for the deaf who signs, and when they would recognize there would be a problem, would come in and help them take care of it, and take care of it for the deaf person. And the deaf people would say, "That'll be fine, thank you for helping me." And you have to take a look at the age range because that has implications for this. Also gender, because that affects their experiences with interpreter services. If you think about it, most interpreters are women. And so when you have a man who needs an interpreter, they're provided primarily with a woman interpreter, but say that they're going to go into the doctor's office, or say that they're going into a meeting that is being attended by all men, and then there's this one woman, and that really has implications for the group dynamics. Race is another factor. Race and ethnicity, whether they're black or Hispanic, Chinese. We have some black interpreters, Hispanic interpreters, and Chinese interpreters, and they have the rights, people of that ethnicity or race have a right to have an interpreter of like race, because they will also understand their black cultural experience, for example. Also, the deaf person's position, their place within the deaf community, and the power structure, where that deaf person fits within that community. The more power the deaf person has within their community, the more different their experience will be with interpreters than with a deaf person who has a very different position within that power structure. So you have to take a look at where that person fits within their own community, because they may have experiences of hostile dependence depending on where they fit within their own community. They may also feel that they have to deal significantly with those feelings, and that really is a big deal. A lot of deaf people feel alone in those feelings. They feel like they may be the only one who feels that way. Do even other deaf people have those same experiences? And they hold that in, and when they go to deaf club and they begin to talk about interpreter services and somebody complains about interpreters, that's one thing, but are they really addressing all of the feelings that they have about that? They need to address their feelings and understand themselves and recognize what their feelings are, and if there is hostile dependency, then how they can learn to separate those feelings and their own feelings from the situation and separate those feelings from that of the interpreter. They have to be able to recognize the fact that if those are their feelings about interpreter services, they can still go ahead and proceed with interpreter services. And oftentimes, deaf people will transfer those feelings because they don't even understand the feelings that they're experiencing. And when an interpreter is present, they resent that dependency that they feel, and they transfer that resentment to the interpreter and to that situation. That hostility about interpreters may create difficulties within the communication interaction in and of itself, and may create dynamics which are inappropriate in that situation. Maybe the situation itself has an effect, because if it's a very important or serious situation, that's one thing versus a more pleasant educational kind of a situation. Maybe it's a situation within a large audience versus a situation where it's one-on-one. Why are they calling an interpreter? Is it for a job situation or a problem, a job interview, and they're bringing in the interpreter? They want to succeed in that situation, and they're hoping that that everything will move smoothly and that there won't be problems, or that the interpreter might even help them achieve the goals that they have for that particular communication. Deaf people have to understand and the fact that they have to work with interpreters. And interpreters do have feelings as well. And interpreters do have their own struggles. They have things that they have to work on in terms of even having the education that they need in order to learn ASL and deaf culture and the interpreting process itself. They need to understand deaf people and their feelings, and they have to understand the hearing person who may not know anything about deafness or the deaf community, and they have to address issues of oppression there. So they have to deal with not only the deaf individual, but also with the hearing individual, and that creates a lot of strife for interpreters. If the deaf person is angry with me and has transferred that hostility towards the interpreter, that creates dynamics for the interpreter as well. Deaf people will say sometimes that, you know, I was all ready for my meeting and I was going to be giving a presentation, I was going to be instructing, or perhaps they're going to be participating in a discussion. And when the interpreter arrives, they say, well, I'd like to visit with you for a while because I want to discuss how you'll be signing. And the deaf person may say, well, I don't really have time for that because I need to prepare. And the interpreter will say, well, I just need to know what your goals are for the meeting or whatever. Let's take another situation where the deaf person is going to the doctor or to an agency for services or whatever, and the interpreter will say, could you tell me why you're here? I just want to have a general idea so I will interpret more effectively for you. So the deaf person goes ahead and tells the reason, and the interpreter understands, but once they get into the doctor's office, then the deaf person feels like, I have to explain this again? I just explained it. It feels redundant to them, and they feel that the interpreter has almost controlled them, because they feel like once I had explained it to the interpreter, I can't even make any changes to my message. I have to maintain that same exact thing that I had just told the interpreter. For interpreters, the interpreters need to become familiar with the psychosocial dynamics that occur within group discussions and meetings, on one-on-one relationships, so that they can understand the dynamics that occur in those situations. They need to understand the psychological mechanisms tied to defense mechanisms and why people behave the way that they do behave in different situations. Interpreters need to be familiar with that so that they will be able to be adaptable and can meet whatever needs that the deaf individual has or the hearing individual has. Interpreters also need to understand that if the deaf individual transfers those feelings of anger or that hostile dependency, that it doesn't really mean them, the interpreter, as an individual, but rather that it's the situation and the fact that they're having to depend on an interpreter. And that that will help the interpreter so that the interpreter doesn't feel it so personally and then think to themselves, well, I love working with deaf people. I worked so hard and I studied and now deaf people hate me. I don't even understand. And deaf people need to understand that that's what interpreters experience as well. Often it also happens that interpreters will say, well, there should not even be a relationship between the interpreter and the deaf person. Oh, we can't have a relationship. I need to draw a line between myself as the interpreter and the deaf person. But if you say that there is no relationship, then that means that in reality, the relationship that does exist is actually a dysfunctional relationship, and it will not be effective. The relationship between the interpreter and the deaf person is very crucial so that they can develop trust with each other. That's very important. You know, every profession has changes that have occurred over time as the profession grows, and changes occur rather naturally. There's an evolution that takes place throughout the experiences of the people within that profession, the research, the training that exists. There's an evolutionary process, and that process of change exists for all professions. If we take a look at the interpreting field, however, it has gone through a great deal of evolution as well. Let me show you the different changes that have taken place within the field of interpreting. Take a look at the next slide. All right. So if you see these four service models, these service models are tied to interpreting. As I look through these, I see these as having created mega shifts throughout time. And the reason I say that is that these shifts were not natural occurrences. If we take a look back through the history of the interpreting field, interpreting is still a very young profession. If we take a look at the early years, say even from 1920 through 1964, many people who worked as helpers and would meet the needs of deaf people who needed some interpreting provided those services really through the helper service model. In about 1960s, a lot of these adults whose parents were deaf perhaps, or who were professionals in the field of deafness, whether they were teachers or ministers, got together and they began to realize that there is more and more interpreting taking place. And they decided that this helper model really may not be the most appropriate approach. So they set up a professional organization. And as they discussed this, they decided that the helper model was not effective, and so they discarded that model and put into place a new model, that of the conduit. Now, the interpreter in the conduit model is simply a machine and functions almost robotically. Hello provides signing services and then makes a shift and will provide voicing services very robotically. And that was all that was provided, such as a machine would provide it. The conduit model meant there was no feeling, no rapport, nothing. Everything was placed on the individuals who were communicating. There was no thought to address cultural differences and language differences. Signed English was the mode provided. Now, in the prior model, the helper model, the interpreters felt comfortable to use ASL or whatever was needed. So you can imagine how deaf people felt when there was that mega shift. Who are you now? I mean, I remember the interpreter used to help me and everything, and now I don't even recognize, I don't even know what to expect. My expectations are completely thrown. And so the deaf person becomes very uncomfortable, and they had no idea how to react. And they became very confused, and therefore very angry. As time went on, that new professional organization had a name, was founded, and they established the Registry of Interpreters for the Deaf, the RID. But as they began to meet and discuss, they began to realize that it seemed the conduit model really was not working. And the reason for that, and this is in the 70s, there had begun to be more research and a better understanding of the interpreter process, and so there was another shift to the third service model, a new model, which was known as the facilitator. And so the interpreter then was far more pleasant and would say, oh, I'll make sure that all the communication takes place. I'm going to facilitate communication between all parties. But this again caused confusion and anger again for deaf people, because this again was a person that they did not recognize. Who was the interpreter? And the interpreter, well, I'm the interpreter and I'm changed, and now this is the service I'm going to provide. And it was very awkward for deaf people. Once again, over time, with RID, in trying to address and trying to improve the field, they tried to come up with a better model and understand that there was a recognition that each model had some problems, and so there was another mega shift, and there was a fourth model established, and that was that of the mediator. Now, this was a new view, a bilingual and a bicultural view, where there would be a recognition of using both ASL and English, two languages, and both hearing American culture and deaf culture. And so the interpreter then was to mediate. But my question to you is, was it really mediating, or is it controlling? What does this model reflect? And so deaf people once again are faced with issues tied to this new model. Now they're beginning to feel like interpreters are taking on far too much liberty to make changes while they're interpreting and to adapt to to the situation, depending on the situation. And deaf people feel that they're not being allowed to feel a part of that process. The interpreter says, well, I know what I'm doing, and I'm going to be making decisions because I'm familiar with deaf culture, and I know hearing culture, and I know what's best. So I will take care of that for you. And deaf people often pause. And as the deaf person, I often have my own script. I've already decided what it is that I'm going to say. I may actually even have a written script. But then through the interpretation, through that new model, you've thrown out my script and rewritten my script. So then, whose culture, whose cultural experiences, whose cultural reality is the interpreter using? My reality or your reality? Is it my experiences or your experiences of the interpreter? Or what you think my experiences might be? Well, for example, one time there was a group discussion and a number of people, and really they didn't know anything about deaf people or the deaf experience, and they were being told a little bit about deaf culture, and they had really been talking about the pathological perspective versus the sociological and cultural perspective, and that was being explained to them. And there was an interpreter that asked me at that time then, is that what you mean when you're explaining this social cultural perspective? And I said, yes, that's what I mean. Now, when the interpreter was voicing, I said, yes, that's what I mean, but the interpreter went on and on and on and on, and I thought, now, wait a minute. And the interpreter kept talking, and I had to wait until the interpreter finished, and the hearing person just kind of nodded and sat back. Now, the reason I'm telling you this story is that I asked the interpreter what she was doing, and she says, well, I have to go into a cultural explanation. I wanted the hearing individual to figure it out themselves, and I wanted to see if I had been clear, and the individual wanted to see if they understood, and I wanted to give full credit to that hearing person. And so what happened in that interaction is that the interpreter took away that power from the hearing consumer. And so the hearing consumer felt devalued. In that process, the interpreter insulted the hearing person's intelligence, but the interpreter felt, well, I have to explain deaf culture to the hearing person. But I then, as the deaf presenter, made me feel as though you meant I wasn't clear in my presentation, that I wasn't effective in my teaching. Maybe I have already written out my presentation and I have already established my intent of the meeting or my presentation or what my purposes are in my instruction for that particular class. And the interpreter might ask me, okay, well, what do you intend to discuss? So I might discuss that with the interpreter, but when I've looked back on those situations and those interactions with the interpreter, what I feel that I and the interpreter have overlooked is what the effect is that we want to leave with the audience, which means that will the audience remember absolutely everything that I've covered? Perhaps not. But I want the audience to leave with a certain effect, and when they go home, that they will have food for thought. And it means then that maybe I have subconsciously become established an effect that I want the audience to leave with, but I haven't told the interpreter what that is. And so the interpreter focuses strictly on the purpose of the meeting and the goals of the specific communication interaction and overlooked what is the ultimate effect of that communication. Also, this model sometimes does not address the form and function of the language. Deaf people always have, you know, how they want to address what they want to say to a person, maybe in a job interview. And so maybe a deaf person might ask the hearing employer, do you have a TTY? And there's a reason for asking that question. Their reason might be that they want to find out if they know anything about deaf people, if they know anything about deaf culture, if they know about TTYs. That's really the idea behind the question. And they may find out if the hearing person knows a little bit, or they may have at least been familiar with the term, or may not even know what it means. But then when the interpreter interprets my question, they go into great explanation as to what a TDD is, and the deaf person's waiting to finish the interpretation of their basic question. And then the hearing response is simply no. And that leaves me, the deaf person, at a loss to know what that no meant. Does that mean that you know what a TTY is, or it means that you don't have a TTY, or does it mean you don't know anything about a TTY? I'm at a loss. I don't know what to do. I don't know what that no means. Does that mean that you understand anything about deafness or not? And so here it was. I had a game plan for my particular question, and that was foiled. A deaf man once told me about an experience that he had, and he is a person in quite a significant position of authority. And there was a new employee that was going to be working for that particular company under him. And so he brought in an interpreter. Now this new hearing person came to see him, and so the deaf man said hello, and they had their interaction. And during that interaction, he noticed that the hearing person was having a hard time with the concept of having a deaf person actually as my supervisor, a deaf person in authority over him. And it seemed that the hearing person was struggling with the concept of having a deaf person in authority. So the deaf person decided to maintain quite a firm posture with this person and throughout that interaction, and yet had a sense that the interpreter was being quite wordy with each thing that was being interpreted. And at the end, the deaf person said, okay, fine, I'll see you next week. But the interpreter went on to say, oh, thank you so much, it was so nice to see you, and I'll see you next week, and went on and on and on. And once the hearing person left, the deaf person asked the interpreter, why did you go on? I just said very briefly, I'll see you. But hearing culture, that's how hearing culture always is at the end of an interaction. Now, understand that that interpreter was a woman, and she is going to be familiar with how women speak, because that is her life experience, and so that is going to affect her choice of language. And so she tends to use more adjectives and uses tag questions, such as, okay, all right, huh, right? And those are reflections of female language, where men tend to be more brief and to the point. And so the dynamics and the communication was skewed based on the interpreter's gender and perceptions. Today, many interpreters go for training and they learn about this new bilingual and bicultural model, and that of being the mediator, and they completely throw out all the old school of thought, and they put on their brand new skin, that of the mediator. And so they meet their deaf person the next time they go out to interpret, and the deaf person may say, I don't want that for my interpreting services. But the interpreter is indoctrinated to believe that's right, that's my role, I should be the mediator. But maybe the deaf person says, no, I want to maintain control of the situation, and a struggle ensues. The deaf individual may want to be specific about what they're looking for in interpreter services, and so interpreters need to work very closely with their consumers in order to meet their needs and follow their game plan. Understand, that doesn't mean the interpreter's ideas or plans for the interaction. Interpreters need to be adaptable and flexible. They need to be willing to change depending on who the deaf consumer is and what the deaf consumer wants and needs. And it could mean that you might provide services from any one of the four service models, or maybe a combination of several models. You need to be adaptable. Now, the reason that the mediator model is tough for the deaf community really has to do with also the socio-political movement within the deaf community. We're now starting a new era, which we might call the post-Milan era, and many deaf people have gotten job promotions, positions of responsibility as teachers. They themselves are better educated, they are more involved with deaf study programs, they are taking on more power for themselves. Deaf study programs have helped deaf people understand themselves and to recognize their own culture and their own language, and they have learned to develop ways to become empowered, empowerment tools in order to take control of their own lives. Section 504 gave more rights and services to deaf people, and now with the advent of the ADA, the Americans with Disabilities Act, this has caused even more changes for the better services, and deaf people can demand their rights. And so there has been a real change that has occurred for deaf people as they have been able to advance as a group. If you'll recall the Deaf President Now movement back in 1985 at Gallaudet University, that was a major event because the deaf people took a stand and said, we must have a deaf president now. And they were able to make that change. And that Deaf President Now movement has spread throughout the country, and more deaf people are taking on more administrative positions within schools and agencies and are taking the forefront. In terms of education, schools for the deaf now are thinking about major changes in order to address a bilingual and bicultural approach. more and more schools are mainstreaming. And this has a major effect on the socio-political movement within the deaf community. So now the interpreting field is also changing. But these two changes are not necessarily parallel or working together. They're sometimes working in diverse ways, rather than working towards the same goal and objective, rather than working together in order to make sure that the changes that occur are going towards the same purposes and goals. So we have interpreter training programs that feel that they are really doing the right thing in the methods that they use and the curriculum they've established in trying to address the bilingual bicultural model or that model of the mediator. But we have people in the deaf community who are not interested in having that model provided for them. And so that creates a problem. Also, are deaf people involved with the mega shifts that have occurred within the models? Oftentimes, deaf people have been left out in the cold and not knowing what to expect from interpreters. And so deaf people don't know what to expect, and they don't know what to interpreters are doing, and it's not their place to explain. Interpreters, you know, don't go in and explain, well, now I've changed the model that I'm using, and so then therefore deaf people are not getting the training or even the education about the interpreter process. And they become totally unaware about what's going on. So interpreters are doing all this studying and they become so involved in learning everything there is to know about interpreters. And yet deaf people know absolutely nothing. And so they feel like deaf people feel as though interpreters know more about deaf culture, more about our language, more about who I am than I know about myself. And of course they don't like that feeling. So now you can see that there are a lot of conflicts between deaf people and interpreters. You know, the code of ethics have stayed pretty much the same over the years, but the perceptions on that code of ethics really have changed. There have been modifications as to what the code of ethics actually means over time. So with the struggle that exists between interpreters and deaf people, I think it's important to recognize that there is oppression. What happens there within the dynamics in which there is oppression, and what happens with the relationship between deaf people and their interpreters? And I'll discuss that a little bit later. I'll do that when we come back.
Oh, Eileen has brought up a number of issues, and that really has given us food for thought. Well, now we will have our first break, and remember, you can call in anytime with your questions. There are three phone numbers. You can call via TTY, voice, or fax machine, and those numbers will appear on the screen.
Hello again. Now I'm going to address the second part of this workshop, and my focus is going to be on oppression. Through research, training, and experiences, interpreters, professional interpreters, the RID, the Conference of Interpreter Trainers, CIT, have all been researching to better understand these issues of oppression and what the implications are for deaf people. And deaf studies programs and deaf people have also been doing research and studying how oppression affects their behavior and their lifestyles, etc. So now, through Charlotte Baker Schenck and her writing, her lectures, I have drawn some of her terminology which addresses forms of oppression. Today I'm going to address three major forms or mechanisms of oppression. I'm going to address language use of oppression. And I'm also going to discuss nonverbal and non-manual behaviors related to oppression. Let me have you take a look at five forms of oppression. Now, in actuality, they have discovered nine forms of oppression, but today I'm going to focus on five of them. So let's take a look at that list once again. So as you look through these lists of five forms of oppression, this can help us to take a look at how those forms maybe add to the hostile dependency that deaf people have. The first mechanism is that of ambivalence. It's somewhat like the love-hate relationship that is created. Now, that ambivalence exists in the difference between ASL and English, in the deaf experience versus hearing people and their experiences, as well as interpreters. And interpreters themselves have a love-hate relationship with deaf people and ASL and deaf culture, too. So ambivalence occurs on both sides. There's ambivalence about ASL and English. Who's right? Is ASL better or is English? And deaf people will take great pride in ASL and in their language, and yet hearing people will say, no, signed English is a far better form of communication, and we need to be using signed English. And that in creates some ambivalence. You take a look at the power structure within the deaf community and outside of the deaf community. Hearing people, hearing professionals who work with deaf people, have their own power structure, and they want to maintain that power. They want to keep that control, and that's why they see signed English as important. And it's important for deaf children to learn from hearing people. And they have a hard time accepting ASL as a language. Now, deaf people feel that ASL is a wonderful language and a wonderful way to express their thoughts and feelings. And throughout their life experiences, teachers have told them that ASL is bad, that they need to sign in English, or that they're using wrong signs, or that their signs need to reflect English more. And so deaf people have that experience, and so they try to sign, even initializing by using, say, the R for the sign for red, and instead of signing chair in the ASL form of chair, they use a C. Or they even initialize the sign for read, beginning with the letter R. And yet when they go and interact with other deaf adults, they find that ASL is a perfectly wonderful way to express their thoughts and feelings and very accepted. And yet when they interact with hearing people, it is not accepted. And so there's this feeling of ambivalence. On one hand, they feel very comfortable with their own language, and yet hearing people tell them that it's not a valid language, and so that creates ambivalence. If you take a look at education and the whole mainstreaming process, you have the schools for the deaf. What is the role model for deaf children and for deaf high school students? Who do they learn signs from? Primarily the interpreter and the teacher of the deaf. That's who their model is, and so that must mean that they are right, and so therefore their ASL usage is incorrect and needs to be set aside or is invalid. Perhaps deaf adults might mention to an interpreter that they are uncomfortable with a particular sign choice and that they would prefer a different sign. And interpreters will sometimes say, well, no, my teacher taught me this particular sign, and so that's the sign and that I'm going to use, and no other deaf people have complained about that use, and so I think that that sign is perfectly acceptable, and I'm going to continue to use that sign. Well, then the deaf person says to himself, I must be wrong. And that adds to this sense of ambivalence. It also refers to self-esteem. When I'm with a deaf person, I feel great, and I am accepted as who I am as a person, and I'm perfectly okay. I am just fine, and I feel comfortable in all my interactions with deaf people. And yet when I interact with hearing people, I have to improve my speech, I have to improve my speech reading. I have to improve my ability to sign in more English. I have to improve my ability to be more hearing in my behaviors. And so they begin to lack trust in terms of hearing people or deaf people. And they become more, they start to use more contact language, a more contact variety, something that is in between their ASL usage and their signed English usage, in order to try to make the deaf people happy and have them accept me. The person makes a shift, and yet they also want the hearing people to accept me. And so they find something in the middle, a middle ground, a contact variety, in seeking the ability to satisfy both sides. You know, let's just take how we feel about our cars, and maybe we have a BMW, and yet we hate taking our cars to the mechanic, because when we go to the mechanic's going to say, well, your car needs thus and such, and they know your car better than you do. And you have to pay for the labor and the parts. And that creates ambivalence. And can I trust my mechanic to take care of my car well and service it correctly? And it's similar to how deaf people feel, because they absolutely love their language and their culture and that experience, and yet at the same time, they hate the fact that they have such problems in interacting with hearing people at times, and therefore they feel torn. You know, my own personal experience in that issue of interacting with both deaf people and hearing people, you know, I teach interpreters, I'm in the training program, I instruct them on deaf culture, and I teach them all about interpreting. And when I interact with deaf people, I interact with them, and they will sometimes say, oh, so you teach hearing people, so that means you must side with interpreters. And I'll say, well, of course I support them and encourage them, and I try to help them develop the best skills possible, but I also side with you as part of my own community. And deaf people will say, well, interpreters are terrific. And if I say that, then they see me as siding totally with the interpreters, and that adds to their sense of hostile dependence and my sense of that. The second form is that of passivity. The deaf consumer feels totally passive, and they let the interpreter take the control. They give away their power. They give up their control and allow the interpreter that control. And they say, well, the interpreter knows what to do. And maybe within their life experiences at home with their parents took control and made all of the decisions for that deaf individual. And the teachers in their schools and the interpreters, say in a mainstream setting, took control and made decisions for that deaf individual. And so they become passive and allow that to continue to happen. Perhaps a deaf person really wants to learn how to become more independent and to take that control and to make decisions for themselves, and yet they don't know how. They lack the tools to do so, and so it's far easier to remain passive. They remain passive sometimes because they are afraid to actually succeed on the job, to make it, and to get the services that they need. Because if they do so, then maybe later, when they lose those services, maybe the company will say, well, since you're doing so well and you've done so well through those services, you probably can function on your own at that point. But I'm not willing to give up that need for interpreter services. Perhaps the deaf person is just simply tired of the struggle that they constantly face in interacting with hearing people and interpreters. And so they finally just say, you know, I don't care anymore. I just give up. I'll just sit back. I'm burned out. I've had it. And they become passive. Interpreters really mean well. They really want to provide those services appropriate for the deaf person. But the deaf person's experiences throughout their lives, where hearing people have constantly oppressed them by taking control, they transfer those experiences that they've had throughout their life to their view of that hearing interpreter, because that hearing interpreter, in essence, reflects the same hearing person that they experienced throughout their life. The next one is adaptation. And that means that there is not this constant struggle in order to fight to get what they want, but rather that there is a process of compromise, that there is a process of accepting and giving and taking, that there is a willingness to accommodate. Say, for example, there is a college classroom, and within that college classroom there are three deaf persons, and there's one interpreter to provide services for all three students. Now, one student wants ASL, one student really prefers signed English, and the third student really is an oral deaf person and needs oral interpreting. So the interpreter might tell the ASL preference student, says, well, I'm going to follow the more signed English, and the ASL deaf person is just going to have to sit back and accept that because they are afraid that they'll lose the interpreter services completely. And so they say, well, okay, well, I guess that's better than nothing. So they then give up their principles, they give up their values because they're afraid to lose the interpreter. And so because they value that service, they go ahead and they say, all right, I'll just accept whatever you give me. I mean, they recognize a need for hearing people, and that need ties in then to the fourth mechanism, and that is emotional dependence. Deaf people throughout their life experiences have been taught or conditioned to rely on hearing people, and that survival literally means a dependence on hearing people. I need hearing people. Without hearing people, I would not literally be able to survive. And many deaf children throughout their educational experience learn that. So now, as an adult with interpreters, they still sense that need for the interpreter. And so they're just willing to go with that because they're emotionally dependent. They allow the interpreter to have control. They allow the interpreter to make the decisions because they're afraid that they would not be able to live without interpreter services. They can't imagine being able to function without the interpreter there. Now, if you take a look at it from the interpreter's perspective, what's important to that interpreter? Sometimes the interpreter may say, fine, I like the fact that they depend on me. I like the fact that you need me and that you depend on me. I need that as a person. That makes me feel valued and worthwhile as an individual. And the interpreter then doesn't want the deaf individual to become independent. They expect and want that dependency, and that the dependency is a positive experience for the interpreter. And so therefore we have a cyclical codependent situation occurring. It's important then for interpreters to understand that they might also fall into what's known as the Messiah syndrome, that they want to save or help the deaf person. You know, if they just depend on me, and that if they do so, I mean, because I'm the only one who can help them, I mean, no one else will help them, and so I will save this deaf person. And they become trapped in that Messiah syndrome, and they get trapped in that position of helping and helping deaf people, and it becomes harder and increasingly harder to say to the deaf person, hey, you don't need to depend on me. Become your own person. We can change and break that reliance and that dependency cycle. But yet interpreters often fall into that trap of viewing themselves as someone the deaf person cannot do without. The fifth mechanism is that of horizontal hostility. You know, hearing people have oppressed deaf people throughout their life experiences. And so then they turn and oppress one another. They pass on that oppression to their fellow deaf people within their community. They resent that oppression that they experience, and so they want to pass it on and get rid of it. And they pass it on to another deaf person. Deaf people within the deaf community often refer to that process as the crab theory. And that means that within the deaf community, group success, supporting one another, and that what is valued is that the group as a whole succeeds, that there's solidarity. And if one person starts to strive and achieve on their own, they are oppressed and are urged to not do so. And if one separates themselves from the group and begins working with hearing people, or perhaps begins working with interpreters, the rest of the members within that group reject that person, see them as wanting to affiliate themselves more with hearing society, and so they reject them. And that deaf individual becomes torn because their membership within the deaf community is so important to them, even though they have to work with hearing people. And so therefore there is this internal struggle, and they see a lot of horizontal hostility and oppression within the community, and they begin to oppress one another. So then how do interpreters begin to fit in and interact with deaf people if deaf people themselves don't want to work with interpreters because they are afraid to work with interpreters because they may be perceived by members of their own community as affiliating with hearing people if they do so, and they don't want to be pushed aside from their own group. These forms of oppression need more research, more study, because we don't really understand them enough. We need to do a great deal more examination of them so that we can provide interpreters with more training and deaf people as well. Both groups need to understand what happens in an oppressive situation. Let's take a look at the use of language in oppression and how language affects oppression. Oftentimes we use language without even thinking. I mean, we may subconsciously be aware, but nevertheless we end up oppressing people by the language we use. Interpreters have developed their profession and have needed ways and signs in order to explain to deaf people factors within the interpreting profession. And so when they want to explain to deaf people, they've tried to come up with signs, and so they borrow signs from ASL and apply those ASL signs to particular terms that are used within the interpreting profession. But oftentimes, the interpreters have forgotten the connotations behind those signs that are based on a cultural perspective, and so they take the superficial denotative use of that sign and apply it in a different situation, and they miss the hidden meanings that are often there. A deaf person might come up to an interpreter and they might ask an interpreter some questions, and the interpreter will say, "No, code of ethics, I can't answer your questions." And so the deaf person will say, "Well, what do you mean by this sign, C and E on your hand like that? What do you mean by that?" And they'll say, "It's the code of ethics." And the deaf person's like, "Okay, well, what does that mean?" Well, you know, that's kind of like rules, or interpreters have their own rules. There are certain things that interpreters must do in order to behave appropriately, and that's what that entails. And the deaf person is still unclear because that just does not seem to fit deaf culture. I mean, that sounds like a hearing thing that they must do to have laws or rules, and that just doesn't jive with their perceptions within their own cultural reality. Let me give you a few examples, and code of ethics is certainly one example, but if the deaf person doesn't understand this sign for code of ethics, but they not only don't understand the sign, but they don't understand what the implications are and what a code of ethics is in and of itself, that's a double whammy. Another example. Do you remember when I told you the story about the bank robber and how the interpreter says, "Well, I have to abide by confidentiality. Now, this sign for confidentiality, you know, has been used for that concept in interpreting. But when deaf people see that sign for confidentiality, deaf people often question that and doubt it. Because, you know, deaf people know about me and they've heard about my situation, so interpreters must have told, but yet they won't tell me anything. But the word's certainly gotten out. But you have to understand that for deaf people, this concept that the sign that's used for confidentiality really means secret. And secrets can be broken. And so when an interpreter says, "Well, I can't tell you it's secret," the deaf person views that as meaning, you won't tell me, but you'll tell someone else. You won't share this with me, but you're going to tell other interpreters? Is that what you mean? And so then we have to stop and realize, no, the reality is that when we're talking about confidentiality, it means I'm not going to tell a soul. My lips are sealed. And many interpreters have already begun to make that shift in terms of how they sign confidentiality and are now more better reflecting the connotative meaning of confidentiality to reflect the fact that they're not going to tell a soul. But we need to become more aware of the language that we use and make changes when necessary, because deaf people don't always understand it. My next example has to do with the concept of impartiality. Deaf people have become really confused because interpreters will often use signs that might reflect, say, indecisiveness. You mean that the interpreter is unsure, that you don't know where you stand? or the interpreter might use a sign that reflects, you know, hands off. I mean, does that mean that the interpreter is just not, you know, not going to have any relationship or involvement at all? Or the interpreter might say, you know, I'm totally withdrawing from this situation. Withdrawing, but you're here. You can't leave, you're here. You need to stay. You can't withdraw from the situation, you're here. What does this mean? Or the interpreter will say, well, I'm neutral. I'm taking a neutral stance. Neutral? What, neutral? It doesn't fit. The sign itself that an interpreter uses doesn't convey the full meaning, the meaning behind the concepts they're trying to convey to the deaf persons. Now, interpreters understand what they mean, but that ends up oppressing the deaf person because they don't feel like they can ask. And so if they ask for an explanation, it's like whatever explanation they get, it's like, okay. So they'll go to a deaf club and they, you know, have to get out all these feelings of anger when they don't understand. If we take a look at the concept of time lag, for example, many interpreters tend to use the sign which, you know, we might consider as being behind or something of that nature, but to a deaf person it means you're going to be behind, you're going to fall way behind. Does that mean that you're not skilled, that you're not going to be able to keep up, that you're going to struggle to be able to follow what the person is saying? I don't get it. So these signs actually carry negative connotations. I mean, think about it. It can mean avoid, or it means that I'm going to, you know, I'm intentionally trying to avoid a situation. So we need to understand that we need to come up with some new terms. And we even have a new English term when we talk about processing time. And that's the time that it takes us to listen to the spoken message, for example, process the information internally before we can express it in ASL. But deaf people still don't understand. And one time a deaf person came to me and said, well, there was this interpreter and I asked a question as to what was happening, and the interpreter said they were using process time, you know, signing it literally. And they wanted to know what was happening. What do you mean? What are you doing? What is actually happening when you are doing that process? It would help if you could use even signs which would reflect the fact that you're taking in the spoken message auditorily, and that it's a mental process which helps you determine how you're going to sign it, and then you express it in sign. And we need to find ways and places where we can all agree on particular signs. One time I was talking to someone and they showed me a sign that, you know, to me it means you're drunk or high. And I thought, is that what processing really is? It's important that we're careful and that we ask deaf people, what do you think? Well, how do you feel that we should express these concepts? And let the deaf people give you ways to express these things better so that it will really mean what it means to you, to the deaf consumer as well. Throughout time, hearing people have been making the decisions as to which signs would be applied to concepts for interpreting. If we take a look at language used by interpreters. Do you remember earlier I talked about how I tried to set up consumer education workshops, the how to use interpreters workshops, and that in and of itself was oppressive. And I just really didn't realize it. We didn't realize that those workshops seemed to be related more to the needs of the interpreter rather than needs of the deaf community. And so deaf people thought, well, great, fine. I mean, it seems to have no application to me. Another example is that interpreters will often say to the deaf person, now you watch me. Now you watch me and you let me know if you understand me. You let me know, and when I'm done, you give me feedback. And the deaf person is like, oh, okay, I'll watch you. And then when we're done, I'm to give feedback. Okay. And I mean, they're dumbfounded because I've come to this meeting for myself. I've come to this meeting, maybe it's job training, or maybe it's a meeting in which I want to participate for the information, so I have to discard my intentions for coming to this meeting, and instead my attention needs to be to the interpreter and what the interpreter is doing. What happened to my rights? I've lost my rights, and now I have been given an obligation to help the interpreter. That's not what I've come for. I've come to learn. I've come to meet my own needs. Sometimes the interpreter will say, do you understand me? And the deaf person kind of pauses for a moment, because in and of itself, that question is so broad, it becomes an oppressive question. And the reason is because you're asking such a broad question. I mean, maybe deaf people understood basically but missed a thing here or there. So then are you asking me, well, yes, I understood absolutely A to Z? Or if I say no, does that mean I didn't understand anything? It would help so much more if you would become more language specific in your questions so that you could ask the deaf consumer, this particular sign that I'm using, is that acceptable? Would you prefer something different? Or if I fingerspell, is my fingerspelling clear? And can you read me clearly on my fingerspelling? Are my facial expressions and my non-manual markers, perhaps my use of space? Use specific questions related to language so that you can get the answers about what you really want to know. And the deaf person then will find those questions far less threatening. And they won't feel so fearful, you know, as a question of, do you understand myself? Because if I say no, the interpreter may leave and I won't even have interpreter services. Well, why didn't you tell me that before? I guess I've just been interpreting for nothing. And end up, the deaf person feels as though there becomes a struggle, and so the deaf person decides to say nothing at all and be passive because they're afraid that they may ultimately lose the interpreter. So that question, questions of that nature then, if you don't understand me, let me know type of question, many deaf people are not going to let you know if they don't understand. And the reason is that, think about the life experiences of that deaf person. They have been conditioned to not tell the teacher, I didn't understand you. I didn't understand you. To ask the hearing teacher that, or to tell a hearing teacher that, because what it would mean is that there's something wrong with me. I don't understand, and therefore, I am less of a person. So now when I have to tell an interpreter that I don't understand, I simply can't say that because I have been conditioned, and it creates a cultural conflict for me. There are other kinds of questions that can become controlling in terms of how the deaf person can actually answer. So if an interpreter says, was I wrong? Did I meet your needs? The deaf person isn't always quite sure how to respond, because when a deaf person goes into a meeting, you know, they'll take in the information and they're trying to figure out the information itself and trying to make sense out of the information. So they're thinking about the content of what they've been taught. And so when they're asked this question related to the interpretation, that means they have to set aside the content and start thinking about the interpretation, and that's not at all where their thinking was. Or maybe the interpreter says, well, I'm sorry, but I'm not very good at signing ASL, so... Well, the deaf person then might just have to say, well, that's fine. I mean, they have to adapt to that and just accept that, because after all, they want an interpreter. I mean, they would be at a total loss without an interpreter. And so, you know, it's hard for a deaf person to say, no, I want a different interpreter. Now, the more power that the deaf person has within the power structure within the deaf community, and in the hearing community, a deaf person with more power certainly can be more assertive in saying, no, I want a different interpreter. But many other deaf people don't have that kind of power within the deaf community. And so whatever interpreter they're given, they feel that they must simply take the services that they're provided with. Interpreters, of course, want praise. They want compliments and to be told that they did a good job. And so deaf people will say, yes, everything was fine. And so you're thanking me. And that's something that interpreters have to stop and pause and think about. Am I really asking the consumer to simply give me praise? Questions like, perhaps during a meeting, there's a group of people, and so if an interpreter says, okay, you're going to sit here, do you plan to participate and say anything? Am I going to have to voice for you? And that kind of a question, the deaf person is going to say, well, yes, I plan to ask a few questions. And immediately the response from the interpreter, the non-manual markers, which send, you know, the message to the deaf person that the interpreter is mad with me, you know, that the deaf person immediately realizes, I've lost my freedom. I cannot participate freely in the meeting and at any moment bring up any points of interest to me. Simply by the response. I don't want the interpreter to be angry with me. And so, you know, I feel that I can't participate. And then if I do, and the interpreter shows this immediate sense of panic as soon as as soon as I've started to speak, then I have to think, oh my gosh, what am I going to say? And I have to make a change to my normal thoughts of how I would express myself and start thinking that I better sign this in English so that the interpreter will understand me. And that totally throws the ability of the person to speak naturally, and it messes up the dynamics of the whole participation. And deaf people finally often feel it's far better to sit back and not say anything at all than it is for them to even try to speak out and have that experience occur. You know, voice interpreting creates a situation where there is control in how the deaf person participates in a meeting. It often forces the deaf person to code switch from ASL to a more English form, and they often feel a dilemma there. It's unnatural, and it causes problems with trust. And there should be team building between the deaf person and the interpreter, and a feeling of real connectedness, and that the communication will flow smoothly and naturally, and that breaks down with those kinds of questions. If you inform the deaf person that, you know, voicing isn't important, you know, that sign interpreting is more important, that you devalue voice interpreting, sometimes that message is sent. If we take a look at the old certification system, for example, there was the use of the term reverse interpreting, and that was natural, I suppose, because back in those days, deaf people really didn't have positions of responsibility and supervision in schools, etc. And so most of the time, interpreters mostly did sign interpretation, and they voiced rarely. Now, with the socio-political movement, deaf people have made great strides and advanced significantly, and that has changed the lives and the work of interpreters. They present and they give training, and voicing skills has become in much greater demand. You know, when we take that word reverse, you know, we've certainly gotten rid of that word. We don't say reversing anymore, but the point is that, you know, even if you take a look, you know, when you drive, when you shift into reverse to go backwards, how often do you drive in reverse? Seldomly, proportionately speaking. So the kinds of questions that interpreters ask deaf people, particularly related to voicing, gives the impression that voicing is not valued by interpreters. But it is important, and interpreters need to continue to work diligently on their voice interpreting skills, because both skills are extremely important. Both skills are equally valid and needed. Now, again, related to voice interpretation, there is a power struggle that can ensue. This occurs because if you take a look at a situation where you have a hearing presenter, more and more now you see team interpreting occurring. And so you have one interpreter standing next to the hearing speaker and their partner sitting out next to the audience, feeding and supporting the working interpreter. So that means then that the hearing presenter is interrupted far less often. You don't see that happening anymore. It's not even allowed, it seems, to interrupt the hearing speaker anymore. So now say we have a deaf speaker and I'm getting ready to give my presentation. Now, interpreters still can interrupt me and say, excuse me, what was that finger smelling? Wait a minute, could you hang on for a moment because it's going to take me a little bit longer to finish my English phrase. And so there's a continued interference with the natural flow. What was that sign again? Interpreters seem to see that it's perfectly all right to interrupt a deaf speaker when it's not all right to interrupt a hearing speaker. Maybe interpreters sometimes feel that it's appropriate to voice over a deaf individual who decides to speak for themselves. And so they're using their own voice, and the interpreter goes ahead and speaks over the voice of the deaf person. But sometimes this happens when the deaf individual is totally unaware of that, and that is very insulting. So the deaf person is speaking and speaking to the hearing people, and they're feeling really good because the hearing people are understanding them, only to find out later that they've been voiced over by an interpreter behind them. And this is extremely resented by deaf people when this occurs. Perhaps the hearing person and I are having a conversation, and I'm a deaf person, and this hearing person has learned some sign. So I want to encourage them, so I'm giving an opportunity for them to use their signs, and I'm chatting with this hearing person, and the hearing person's understanding quite well. And then I find out later that the interpreter has been interpreting everything I've said. Now, I didn't ask the interpreter to interpret that interaction. Wait just a moment. my intention is to try the hearing person, to try to allow the hearing person to try and understand me. And if I need your services, I'll ask for it. But to just to go ahead and interpret without my knowledge, who gave you that permission? Say, for example, well, actually, at one time in the past, I was on the New Jersey Commission inspecting services for deaf schools, and we took a look at programs for deaf children. And during those commission meetings, there were a number of people. Now, that commission met for about 3 years. Now, I was the only deaf person on that commission, and obviously I was the token deaf person, but I was aware that that was the case. But I served on that commission. Now, there was a commissioner, the chairperson, who I'd asked a question of. I wanted to question something that the chairperson said, and so the interpreter interpreted that. Now, the chairperson stopped and thought quite a while about what I had said. The interpreter suddenly interrupted and said, "Do you understand her question?" And I couldn't believe that that had happened, because I personally thought that it was wonderful that I had made him stop to think, because I may or may not have him change his mind, but I thought it was fine that we could negotiate the situation. I had my own mental game plan. I already had my own text. And the interpreter interrupted with that natural flow, insulted the chairperson, did not think highly enough of that person as if they wouldn't ask me. That was not the point whatsoever. I mean, if the chairperson didn't understand, the chairperson would have asked me. And instead, the interpreter interjected and assumed and affected the status of that person. Interpreters, many times, will say the phrase, you know, deaf people are my clients. Now, let me tell you, I am not your client. We use your services as interpreters, okay? Interpreters will go out to interpreting assignments, and they'll introduce themselves and say, "Hello, I'm the interpreter." But sometimes they'll say, "I'm just the interpreter," or "I'm only the interpreter." Let's take a look at how that's perceived by the hearing person when an interpreter says, "Oh, you're just the interpreter." But then when they see me as the deaf person, they often make that transition and say, "Oh, well, you're only the deaf person. Oh, you're just a deaf person." And the language that's used by the interpreter affects my status, and I lose status in the decisions made by the interpreter. Words like "just" and "only" are, you know, language terms of powerlessness. And women need to understand how they use language in particular, which will oftentimes reflect the deaf person's status and position, personality, mood, intelligence, and even education, and so on. Next, I'd like to address nonverbal and non-manual behaviors, because it's interesting how we behave physically can affect and can actually encourage or reinforce oppression. The signing space that we use. Say that you have a huge hearing audience, and there's only a small number of deaf people who have been placed off in one corner, so an interpreter is seated and signing very, very smallly in a very small signing space. So the deaf person might say, "Sign a little bit larger." And the interpreter might say, "Oh, I can't, because, oh my gosh, there's so many hearing people and it's going to be distracting to the hearing people. Can't do that." And so then what it does is it gives more power or status to the hearing people than it does to the deaf people. Maybe what we have is a situation where the interpreter is not comfortable with him or herself. And so he or she is oppressing themselves because they perceive themselves as maybe a woman who needs to be very polite, and as a woman I need to be dainty and sign small, and that they're not even comfortable with the use of signing space or naturally using non-manual markers. And so that affects how the interpreter interprets and affects the message. The message is no longer accurate because the non-manual markers for grammar are even gone. And that affects the message as a whole and a lot of meaning gets lost. The natural movement of signs becomes stilted. Take a look at even where you put the deaf people. If the interpreter stands right next to the speaker, or whether the interpreter stands way off to the side where the deaf people are relegated to the corners and off to the side. I've seen some interpreters go ahead and stand center stage right next to the speaker, and sometimes that makes them extremely nervous because all the hearing people can see them too. But they realize the importance of allowing the deaf audience equal opportunity to look not only at them, the interpreter, but the speaker as well, and that the deaf people have equal opportunity as the hearing audience to have the visibility. Or the interpreter who chooses to stand or even sit way off to the side, which sends the message that deaf people are devalued and that they have a lower status and they need to be hided and shoved aside where they can be less visible and they're far less important than any other members of the audience. When there's a lack of facial expression and only signs provided, now, this happens sometimes because women interpreters particularly don't always feel comfortable using a lot of facial expression, and that might come even from their oppression as they experienced life and growing up, and that they were taught not to use a lot of facial expression, and so that's a message that has been conditioned lifelong, and so they have a hard time using natural facial expressions when interpreting. Another perception that exists has to do with transliterating and using signed English, and there is a myth that is felt throughout the country that transliterating also means a lack of facial expression or non-manual markers. I want to tell you that this is untrue. Deaf people need to get the message not only from your hands but also the space that you use and the facial expressions and grammatical non-manual markers shown on the face. Also part of the language, there are ASL discourse markers, and they are grammatical rules tied to ASL and also tied to non-manual behaviors. It's important for the interpreter to tell the consumer when there's the next part, and so their use of non-manual shifts to show cohesion and to let the deaf people know that we are now making a shift to the next thought, or that there's the speaker is going off the point temporarily, so that the deaf people have equal access to even the structure of the message. If that's not given, deaf people cannot feel the flow of the message and understand the actual organization of the message the speaker has. Say that there are a number of people in a meeting and the interpreter is interpreting for the deaf person, and all of a sudden at the end they say, this question is directed to you, the deaf person. And all of a sudden the deaf person kind of sits up and is like, oh, this question is for me? I mean, talk about make me look stupid. And this has occurred because they've been just taking in the message, and they're also taking time to process the information and make sense out of the message too, because deaf people have processing time as well as they follow the train of thought of the message. I think it's important for interpreters to recognize that a question is going to be asked of the deaf person first, so that the deaf person then becomes ready for the question, and then the interpreter interprets the question in which then the deaf person can very easily be prepared to answer. You know, we see now team interpreting occurring far more throughout the country than it was in the past. So you have a deaf person sitting in one place and the feed interpreter sitting next to the deaf people. And so when the deaf person's watching the interpreter, they feel a lack of eye contact. And the reason is because the interpreter is making eye contact with the feed interpreter. But then the feed interpreter is nodding and saying, it's very good, you're doing fine, and everything's just flowing smoothly. But for the deaf consumer, I'm thinking, look at me, I don't even feel like I'm being communicated to. It feels so uncomfortable. It's like, why am I even here? I feel like I'm not even being addressed because that eye contact is being shifted to the feed interpreter. And it begins to feel as though the interpreter is not even here for me at all, but is here for the support interpreter. And that is very confusing. And so these are just a few examples of nonverbal behaviors that need to be analyzed very carefully so that we can understand the messages that we send, messages that we may not even be aware of. So we need to examine these messages so that we can improve the messages that we send so that we can be less oppressive to deaf people. And in that way, that relationship between interpreters and deaf people can improve. I'd like to talk a little bit about a term that I call backdraft of interpreting. If you'll recall the movie entitled Backdraft, there was a room where a fire had started and it was smoldering and the flames were starting. But then someone opens the door, and once air rushes into the room, it causes this terrible backdraft and a firestorm, and the individual becomes immediately burned by the fire. Backdraft from interpreting has had major implications for deaf people. Now, the reason why I say this is because if we take a look at, for example, ADA, now we know that the objective of ADA was to provide better and improved services and to meet the rights of deaf people and disabled people, and certainly that's appropriate. But there was such a mega shift that deaf people were totally left unawares. And they didn't even have the empowerment tools in order to handle that mega shift. Many deaf people were not prepared for the changes that took place, and oftentimes interpreters were not even really aware or prepared for the changes that occurred either. Say that you have a company and there is a deaf employee who's working. Well, the supervisor comes over to that employee and shows the employee this form, which is actually the bill for interpreter services from the interpreter. And the employer says, "So, take a look at this." Well, the deaf person becomes totally shocked and can't even believe their eyes, because the bill is for more money than I even earn. And they don't even know how to react to the, because the employer has even shown them this bill. Does that mean that the next time I shouldn't even ask for interpreter services? What does it mean that the employer has shown me that bill? I mean, should I say, "Gee, thanks"? Does that mean that you want me to look for interpreters that are cheaper? What is the meaning? What is the message sent? Does that mean that I am not worthy of the costs related to interpreting services and I shouldn't even work there? And there's a lot of stress tied to that and a lot of fear. I mean, they don't know what to do. They begin to fear loss of their own job. Many deaf people don't stop to think about the fact that I am very important. I have a great contribution for that company. You've trained me well, and you've given me good services, and in return, I do a good job for the company. But many deaf people don't think of that. They haven't developed the empowerment tools to allow them to think in that way. The ADA states very specifically about interpreting services, but it does not say that the interpreter has to be certified. It does not state that. Rather, it uses the term qualified. And there is no definition of the term qualified in the ADA. So what does that mean? That interpreters don't need to worry and work hard and struggle to gain the skills needed for certification? Does that mean a company will say, "Well, I think that interpreter is qualified. They can sign. They move their hands. They can do it," even though the deaf people will realize that that isn't a qualified interpreter and they want a qualified interpreter? And an employer saying, "Well, this is fine. This is good. Hey, this person's learned sign and they can interpret. They're doing well." And that creates a real struggle. And more interpreters are beginning to feel like, "Well, I don't need a training. I don't need to improve my skills because I'm still getting jobs. I'm being hired for interpreting assignments all the time." So this can very much cause deaf people a great deal of suffering. But interpreters also suffer. The profession of interpreting suffers as well, because many interpreters really do care, really work very hard to gain certification, to improve their skills, and to do whatever they can. And then here, other interpreters who are not qualified are being hired in those positions instead, simply because they're willing to do the work for cheaper fees. All of these issues that I have been discussing today have implications. I mean, really, I have just barely scratched the surface. There is so much more that we need to take into consideration. I hope, with all that you've heard today and the mentioning of the issues that I've brought forth, that deaf people and interpreters can work together and dialogue, share. From this point on, they dialogue over these issues. You know, in New Jersey, last summer, the New Jersey Registry of Interpreters for the Deaf and the New Jersey National Association of the Deaf planned a get-together, and they put together a weekend, an ASL weekend on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and members from the deaf community and interpreting community got together, lived together, and had a total silent weekend where all communication occurred in sign. I would say there was probably 15, maybe 20 deaf people that attended, and the hearing people entailed interpreters, consisted of interpreters who had been working for a long period of time. There were parents, there were teachers, there were a number of people that all got together for this weekend, and it was very successful. I hope these kinds of things happen more frequently. I've talked about oppression, and deaf people and interpreters both need to learn how to remove the effects of oppression. Deaf people need to learn more about themselves and who they are as deaf people, their language and what their culture is, and the role of interpreting, the interpreting process, and empowerment tools so that they can lead their own lives independently. Interpreters have to do likewise. They need to understand themselves. Why is it that they've chosen the interpreting profession? Is it because they have their own needs of the Messiah syndrome? They have a need to help? That's what they want? They need to learn about their own culture, about their language, and about deaf people and their culture and their language of ASL too. Interpreters, by learning this, can begin that process of empowering and removing the oppression that exists. But oppression is going to be something that continually occurs on a day-by-day basis, depending on who the people are and depending on the different situations that occur. You know, I had an experience once that when I was on the New Jersey Governor's Commission, and if remember I told you about serving on that commission, there were a large number of people, and I got there one morning, and the meeting hadn't started, so people were milling around and drinking coffee, and the chairperson came over to me and anxiously said, "Well, we don't have an interpreter. The interpreter just didn't show up, and they've canceled. And so, well, there is someone on the commission who's willing to interpret and can sign, and this person," now understand, this person's on the commission. And I listened to what the chairperson said, and this woman seemed very eager and willing and said, "Well, I do sign." I didn't even really have time to think. I mean, I didn't want to make people angry. And so initially I said, "Well, okay. And we were just about ready to start, but I had given this more thought, and I thought, wait just a minute. And I stopped and I said something to the chairperson. I said, "You know, we need to cancel this meeting because this is unfair, because the other hearing members of this commission cannot benefit from me, and I cannot benefit from them. This member of the commission is giving up their position on the commission in order to interpret. I think the meeting needs to be canceled. There's no way we can take votes, etc. And if not, I'm leaving, because there just really isn't an interpreter available." And they said no, that's what they were going to do. So I got up, took my purse and my things, and started to walk out. Now, I'm telling you, I felt like any second I was going to be riddled with bullet holes as I walked out my back to the whole commission. And when I got in my car, I mean, I just couldn't believe it. But I'm telling you, I felt so powerful, because I told them they could not do it. Enough is enough. And sure enough, from that point on, they always had interpreters, not only one but two from that point on. And that helped them stop and realize that this was not something that they could take lightly. I'd like to close with two stories. Are you familiar with the play Fiddler on the Roof? You have a story where there's a father, and his name is Tevye, and he has daughters. Now, in Russia, there was a strong, large number of Jewish people, and they lived on farms. And one daughter came to her father, and he said, "Well, my boyfriend and I want to get married." And Tevye heard what she had to say, and he started thinking, on the one hand, he's thin and homely, very plain. I mean, he doesn't have much of a job. He's a tailor. But on the other hand, he's been good to my daughter. And he, I know, is a hard worker, and he would do what he could to provide, and he would follow the Jewish tradition. I know he would provide her with a good home. So he gave his consent. You can get married. A little bit later, another daughter came to her father, and she said, "Father, the two of us want to get married. We are so in love." And the father listened to what she had to say, and he paused to think. He thought, on one hand, she's so young, but they do love each other, and he's a farmer, and he has land, he has property, and there are a lot of reasons to approve it. But on the other hand, he's a Cossack, and Cossacks have all this time oppressed Jewish people. And so he immediately said no, and he told his daughter, "No way, not at all." Now, with interpreters, for me, on one hand, interpreting services, you know, is wonderful. Interpreters are human, they care, they give of their time, they give sweat and blood and tears as they struggle and learn ASL and deaf culture and learn how to interrelate with deaf people and participate in deaf culture. On the other hand, you know, for me, there is no other hand. And the reason is because I value interpreters. Interpreters have become a window to the world. And I value that so very much. I want interpreters to work together with me. I want us to work together and have a better understanding of the dynamics that take place. The other story that I want to tell you is about two mules. And there was one mule standing on one side and another mule, and they were chained together. And they struggled one against the other. Now, each had a pile of hay, and both of them were very, very hungry and wanted to eat. But as the one mule would struggle to go towards his pile of hay, he couldn't move enough to get to his hay. And the other mule was struggling going in the opposite direction in order to get to his pile of hay. And they hated each other. They were furious with each other because they were being held back from their piles of hay. And they fought and struggled against each other. And finally, they looked at each other and, "I'm hungry. I want to eat my hay. I mean, the hay is there. I need to eat it." And the other mule said, "Well, I'm hungry too. There's my pile of hay and I want to eat it too." And as they looked at each other, they thought, "We need to come to work through a solution. So, well, I'd be willing to share my hay. Come on." And so the two of them went over and ate the one pile of hay until it was completely gone. Then when they were done, they could walk together over to the other pile of hay, and they shared that pile of hay until it was gone. And together, in cooperation, they were able to succeed. Both had their needs met, and both got what they needed. The same principle is true, that deaf people are integrally linked to interpreters. And so deaf people and interpreters need to work together so that they can achieve both what deaf people need and want and what interpreters need and want. And through that cooperative effort, working together, we can achieve that. Good luck, and thank you. We will have a question and answer period soon, right after our next break.